Hello, YouTube. Welcome back to the Elden Ring PC Let's Play. We're on episode number 255. And unfortunately, my OBS did not record game audio. So what we're doing instead is a commentary overlay with some music on top of it so that we can... It was like, granted, you're not going to hear any sword clangs or shield bangs, but it's better than throwing this entire episode out into the garbage. So, we are in this big grand cloister, and we are going to just take a look around. We're going to make sure that everything is explored to its fullest. That's the goal. We have the time, and we are going to do that. So, this might be a little slower than others have explored it, but I'm going to do my best to be exhaustive. See if there's anything over here behind these pillars. Nothing. This area is so gross. I don't like this rot stuff at all. I don't know. It creeps me out. It's gross. I like the idea of the conflict between what is present versus what is coming or is changing. So I like the symbolism of it. I get grossed out by the aesthetic of it. So we have a bunch of, looks like pests down there, or what do you call them? Servants of Rot, I believe. So yeah, let's just jump over here, and then can we make this jump? Okay. So, well, that's good. We're fine. Let's grab this golden centipede, and we're going to scooch around here and see how we can get down. And it looks like there's a pillar there. So this is great level design in that it's self-describing. Since we missed the jump, though, we're going to go back to the site of grace and make that jump and just make sure we're not missing anything. But the level design is really good in this game. Duh, this is like the dumbest thing you could say, but it's true. Like, here's an example where you're trying to figure out how to go down, and they could have done it without a downward-facing pillar. Can we make the jump? We did. Yay! So over here, you can see more of the ground being revealed. And you're like, okay, wow, I want to go down there. How do I get down there? And I can see these patrolling servants of Rot with their pest threads that are going to get me. So I need to be careful. Aha! And we were rewarded for coming back with a golden rune 10, which is not chump change. So you get a chance to see what you're about to face. And that's true in like this whole game, but it's especially true at this point, and it's really cool. So what I was saying, though, why it's good level design to me is that, okay, you know you need to get down, so there's a hole. It's pretty obvious you have to jump down here. And then as you go towards the other side here, you can see the slope. So this is hinting to us, hey, you can probably just jump down here, land on this thing, and then you can see over in the distance there a pillar that's kind of fallen down. So you could totally fall off of this if you want. Or you could take this for sure safe route and fall on that pillar. It's just cool. Like, they really thought of how we were going to experience this in the best way. And it just blows my mind how talented the From Software level designers are. They're just so good. And this is like right out of, it feels like it's right out of a D&D, you know, novel or module or something like that. It really does feel as if we are walking around in someone else's like dungeon master adventure. And so anyway, we're going to take out these Servants of Rot as best we, they shouldn't be too hard, like 3 hits with Stormblade. And also, we summoned the rock pile to help us. These demi-humans are amazing at grabbing and keeping aggro, as well as being so numerous, you don't have to worry about like what they're doing, because they're probably helping you somehow. And also, look at how tough they are when you level them up. Like, I think they're +9 right now, and they barely got hurt. So we're going to keep looking around in this area. Definitely some drops down there we want to get. So let's make sure we have our boluses armed and ready to go. And let's scooch down here. And uh-oh, something's happening from underneath of us. And up, yep, there's a big beast of some kind. We're going to run. And by run, I mean cover ourselves in rot and just try and flee. Let the demi-humans just kind of hang out there while we prepare and refresh ourselves with our blue Kool-Aid, our red Kool-Aid, and all of our various power-ups. They are definitely keeping... Okay. That is a putrid tree avatar, it looks like to me. I think that's what that is. It doesn't have a boss bar, so I'm not 100% sure. But yeah, that's what it looks like. Anyway, they're keeping good aggro, although me hitting him for all that damage kind of angered him a bit, and he wants to take it personally, which I don't blame him for. But we've almost got him to halfway, now he's down to half, so just a few little more hits maybe, as long as we don't die. Let's do some Lion's Claw on him, get him stunlocked maybe. Yep, there we go, there's a stunlock, but I'm just going to keep doing Lion's Claw and take him out so that we don't have to deal with this guy anymore. And look at our demi-humans. They weren't really shook. They still have over half of their health intact. So that's really, really good stuff. Definitely recommend them. You shouldn't sleep on the demi-humans in terms of like ignoring them. Yeah, so we're going to grab the Smithing Stone 7, which made the whole thing worth it. Plus, we got a golden seed, I think, from beating that guy. I don't even remember what I just saw as I'm watching and adding this commentary, but I'm pretty sure you get a golden seed from there. So now let's see if we can have a healing spell for our demi-humans to get them back to health. And unfortunately, we don't have one. It's kind of sad because I would like to reward them with a tasty treat of some HP, but I don't have that ability. I could throw down a warming stone in hindsight, now that I'm thinking about it, while I'm watching myself play. But, alas, they get no HP goodies from me, warming stone or otherwise. So we're going to go and take a look at the rest of this area. We're going to get some passive regeneration on from that shield, as well as some bestial vitality. We're going to scooch around and make sure that all of this stuff is fully explored. As I mentioned, there's not too much more to it. I think back here we find some nascent butterflies. Yep, and that's about it. Nothing more to say or do down there. So let's go forward and see if we can try and figure out A, what the heck is going on that they're worshipping down here, because you can tell they're worshipping something. And also, B, if we can somehow use the rock pile as they are intended to be used, which is causing a ruckus. So, yep. Okay, so two hits. Three hits if they're alerted to our presence, two if they're not. And looks like the J-Rock and his buddies are doing their thing. So you might not understand what I'm saying with some of these references. So Rock Pile, that's a reference to J-Rock and his crew. J-Rock is, of course, from the Trailer Park Boys. He's the rapper there, the microphone assassin, if you will. That's one of my favorite shows. So I kind of just did a lap there to alert the followers of Rot to the Rock Pile and say, hey, Rock Pile, meet these guys. Kill these mosk. All right, so that is completed. Now there's one left. They're so content to worship whatever it is they're doing that they don't even see us killing and murdering all of their companions. So that's interesting in and of itself. And what is he doing? Like, I just don't understand. So we're gonna take him out. You can go away. But he does wind up getting me with his rubber band body attack, which kind of sucks, but at least we didn't get hit by any of them pest threads. Those are nasty. Some of the YouTubers that I watch call those ropes. And I'm not quite sure why they call them ropes, because it says pest threads. So, anyway, I'm obviously kidding. I know why they call them ropes. I'm just being an idiot. Trying to fill the time with some vocal chatter. So over here, there's a coffin we can rest in, and obviously we're going to do that. But first, I want to see if this area opens up anymore when we go up through here. I'm concerned about what they're worshiping, because usually that means some kind of, something that they find honorable or worth worshiping in another way in terms of, like, might or power. So we'll see what's up here. The area is just so cool looking, too. All these little rot, I don't know what you would call them, broccolis. And we have a chest, and this feels like a trap. It's just sitting there in a dark room, surrounded by pillars, and I'm pretty sure this is a trap. So I'm probably going to get teleported somewhere. And no, it's not a trap. Okay, so we get the scorpion stinger. Interesting. So they were worshiping a chest with a weapon in it, and that weapon is the scorpion stinger, which has scarlet rot buildup as a dagger, and a repeating thrust FP cost of 7. That's not too bad, but it's interesting that they were worshiping this. So, dagger fashioned from a great scorpion's tail, glistening with scarlet rot, a ceremonial tool used by heretics, crafted from the relic of a sealed outer god. So that's why they were worshiping it, because it's a relic of a sealed outer god. And so the people that worship rot, the folks that we just took out with all the dankly arms and centipede-like body, they were worshiping a dagger because it was from a sealed outer god's piece that's shaped like a scorpion. So that kind of lines up with, like, some of the other things that we've already fought, like those falling star beasts and whatnot. Maybe it came from a falling star beast. I don't know, but we're going to hop in this coffin, and how metal is it that in FromSoft games, they have elevators, but they also have coffins that you get into that then you wiggle through to get it to fall over a waterfall. And in this case, this waterfall is full of rotten water. It's the Lake of Rot Water, or it could be blood. I mean, we don't know, but I don't think that that would really help us absorb any damage. If you're inside of a big, you know, stone casket, how is that going to help you absorb fall damage? Well, anyway, it's just metal as heck, and I dig it. So here we are in this new place where it looks like some kind of organic glowing matter is adorning everything. This reminds me a little bit of the big ancestor that we fought, that big deer with the antlers and everything. Maybe there's a relation to that. Huh. It also kind of reminds me of a level from Skyrim later in the game where there are, like, mushrooms that glow. I wonder if that's an homage to that. Maybe. This is really cool, though. Such a cool time to be a nerd and into video games. I can't wait to see what they do next, especially with the DLC. Although, I still have a lot to go in my playthrough. Like, after this, we still have to go to the Consecrated Snowfield. We still have to go and get through the Hallig Tree, the Brace of Alphalia F.E.L. or whatever. Then we have to kill the Fire Giant. Then we have to get to Crumbling Pharamas. There's, like, quite a bit of stuff left for me to do, in addition to a bunch of quest lines that I have probably broken or screwed up. So I'll have to catch those on NG Plus if I ever get it to that point. I am going to try. I am not going to give up. So far, so good. It seems like the game, if you just grind a bit and you get yourself to the point where you're not going to just get tumbled down and one-shotted, you can kind of persevere. I would say it's a heck of a lot more approachable than The other games I've played by them, which includes Dark Souls and Dark Souls 2 and a little bit of both of those, but not even close to being, you know, 1 or 2% done with those. Like I said, I'm kind of a casual noob, so. Anyway, we're at a boss wall here, a fog wall, and we are going to see what we can equip to try and make us as tough as possible. We added more hit points with the Crimson Medallion plus 1, and we kept on our strength talisman, as well as the Radagon Sword Seal. I'm just trying to figure out if it's worth it. And now I think what I'm going to do is just kind of tool up. I keep these different armor sets for just such an occasion. And this is one that I got recently from the Tree Sentinel. It's the full Tree Sentinel set, and it is great. It gives me about 82 poise, all of it on. And while I'm heavy, I can figure out a way around that usually by downgrading a few pieces and putting on the Arsenal Charm. I still need to go and get the Great Arsenal Charm from beating the Pot Warriors Gauntlet, where you have to fight those three Pot Warriors. I haven't done that yet, but I shall at some point. All right, so, yep, we're almost done getting tooled up here. We're down to medium load. We just had to change out our gauntlets. We don't need boluses, hopefully, in this place. I'm going to guess no. That would suck if we do, but I'm going to swap that for some turtleneck. We'll keep the flesh and the crab, and I don't think I'm going to use a shield at all. And I think that looks pretty good. That seems like a decent loadout. I've got both my greatswords here, so I can do distance with the Stormblade and up close and personal with Lion's Claw, which is great. I am going to swap my summons, and I'm going to use probably the Mimic tier or the Shieldy Boys. I don't remember what I picked. Okay, I'm going with the Mimic tier. That's a pretty good choice, because two big thuggy guys like us on one, whatever this thing is going to be probably a decent fight. We probably have a fighting chance to win. So, let's go ahead and up. I can't bubble because I already used my bubble, but that's all right. We have a significant amount of flasks, and we have these other buffs that we can put on. We're going to turtleneck, ritual flesh and crab. And then we are going to summon ourselves, our mini-me. And oh boy, it is Astel, natural born Lila of the Void. This is a fight that actually I fought with Britta recently, and so I kind of am not as shook about it. He's going to hit me with his tail. I can't get the timing down for that no matter what I do. I am a little bit better at it, though, this time around. And I read the other thing that I fought was some other Astel, like Destroyer of Stars or something like that. I don't remember the name. But it's a version of this that's even harder. So if you can get through that one, you can probably get through this one. It's the same moves and everything, except for I think that one, the one I'm talking about, actually picks you up and chews you. I don't know if this one will do that, but look, it's already half dead, and we haven't even taken that much damage, really. We've taken some, but we have flasks, and we have ourselves to thank. So after they disappear, that bomb, by the way, does a lot of damage in an AoE. And then this right here, he's gonna probably hit us, or she, yeah, with these meteors. This is difficult for me to dodge when I'm not even looking at him. But Mini-Me should be at least coming around to fight. There you go. Come on, Mini-Me. So yeah, we're gonna hit the weak spot on Astel is the head. And yep, that nebula attack is gonna do delayed damage. So if you see that coming, get out of the way. And then this one has like waves. You can actually jump over some of those. You could like do a jumping dodge. And then here he's gonna shoot us with some kind of beam, I thought, but no, maybe not. So yep, we're gonna just keep hitting. We run out of blue Kool-Aid here. We got poked, but it looks like we're still okay. We have quite a bit of health thanks to those talismans and our vigor. And now we're just gonna keep swinging at him in a paranoid way. Just keep getting knocked down. You're going to keep knocking us down. We're going to keep shooting you with Stormblade, and eventually something hopefully will hit. because we only need to hit them one more time. And there we go. Astel, natural born of the void, is down. And we're hopping around because we're happy. And we got the remembrance of the natural born, which is going to provide us with two options. One is usually like a thing you can wear, and one is a thing you can either use as a weapon or equip somehow besides wearing it, like an armor thing. So yeah, we're going to go and try and find a site of grace. There it is. We're going to go forward and we're going to rest. Then after we rest, we're going to probably, I would think, go to the round table hold and then see what we can get for this remembrance. And you can duplicate these remembrances and get both of them if you can find a mausoleum that will let you clone it. So here, we don't have enough to level. I'm going to go ahead and pop some hard runes here. These are worth 5,000 each, I know from previous experience. So I think 10 will do it. I think 10 will give us enough to make that shortfall for our level. There we go. Yep, we have enough to level, and we're going to get another point in, I believe we pick faith. Yes, sir. So we're up to 18 faith. That's pretty good. Okay, so now I think we're going to go to, we might actually look at the inventory of what it is. Yeah, so let's look at it real quick and read the description and so on. And what is it? Where are they? There it is. All right. Remembrance of the Natural Born. Remembrance of Astel, Natural Born of the Void, union to the Erd Tree. The power of its namesake can be unlocked by the Finger Eater, a malformed star born in the lightless void far away. Once destroyed an eternal city and took away their sky. Wow, that's intense. So, and it's also hewn into the Erd Tree, which is interesting. So that means that these beasts are somehow connected deeply to the Erd Tree, even though they're in these weird caves and things, and they're a distance away. So, Not sure. But hey, we found an elevator. We're going to go up and do a little victory dance, a little bop and jive. And yeah, as we're going up, why don't we just put on our old Grey Worm costume? That would probably be a good idea. And I really like this outfit. It's just really cool. I like the ropes on the feet and the hands. So where did this take us, YouTube? Let's see. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. I know where we're at. We are above the Albinoric village. So we were in the village of Albinorics down there and trying to get up here. And we're like, how the heck does that happen? Well, you can't. It's a whole different area. This is the Moonlight Altar. And you can't get to this unless you beat that boss. You can't get to that boss without that ring. So this is tied into Ronnie's quest line. And this is awesome. We're going to definitely be doing this area next. But first, I want to go back to the round table hold. And let's see what we can get from that remembrance. And just like normal, we're just going to go and see this little lady with the bells on the stick, Inia. And it looks like we can get Bastard Stars or Waves of Darkness. So I did get Bastard Stars on my other character, Britta, that I was playing through. And that was awesome, but it requires intelligence. And you can see in our stats, we don't have a great intelligence. We have a 9, I think. That's not the focus for Grey Worm at this time, at least with this respec. So we're going to skip that. We're not going to get either of those things. So yeah, I think that's going to do it. We're going to head back to the Moonlight Altar just so that when we pick up where we left off, we'll be in the right spot. And also interestingly, as this is tied with Ronnie's quest line, we might be finishing up her quest line pretty soon here. So yeah, I'm excited about that. Anyway, let's go ahead and fix up our... or check our equipment real quick. And I guess, okay, I thought we were going to do our talismans, but I guess not. So anyway, if you're like this, please feel free to subscribe. Click the like button or the bell for updates. If you would like to say anything, that's what the comments are for. Thank you for watching, and I'm sorry again about the audio. Take care. Bye-bye.